All right, y'all, today we're putting together yet another PC part picker list. This one is gonna be for a $700 PC that targets 1080p gaming at well over 60fps on max settings. And you know, for the most part, you can build out a PC to fit whatever budget you have. So while you can go under $700, I personally think that this is the bare minimum spec that I would actually recommend a friend or family member go out and buy if they were trying to get a decent gaming PC for 1080p. What that more or less means is that I've already cut all the corners that I feel comfortable cutting with this parts list. And anything further, I think, compromises on the build too much, either in one area or another, that keeps it from feeling balanced and well-rounded. So here we go, guys. This is our $700 1080p gaming rig. Let's get into it. This video is brought to you by the EVGA RTX 2060 KO. The card features 6 gigs of GDDR6 memory, a quiet dual fan design, and full metal backplate for added rigidity. Fast yet affordable, the RTX 2060 KO is built on NVIDIA's Turing architecture, allowing users to experience RTX on for next level realism in games. Click on the link below to learn more. Now, it's probably no surprise that I'm going with a fresh new Ryzen 3 processor for this parts list. Bear in mind that the Ryzen 3 parts aren't out at the time of filming this video, but they're gonna be available in just a couple days, so hopefully you'll be able to get your hands on one if you're interested in putting together a build like this. Specifically, I'm going with the Ryzen 3 3100. This is the entry-level chip of the two, coming in at $100. You can see that it's in Great British Pounds right now because I'm actually on the UK page, since the regular Amazon.com site doesn't have a pre-order page available for the Ryzen 3 chips just yet. The Ryzen 3 3100 is a 4-core, 8-thread part. It's got 18 megabytes of cache. I believe 16 megabytes of that is L3 cache, and then 2 megabytes of L2 cache, and then you also have a 3.9 gigahertz max boost. Of course, this can be overclocked further depending on your cooling situation, things like that, so you can get a little bit closer to Ryzen 3 3300X performance, which costs about $20 more. However, at the same clock speeds, the 3300X is still bound to perform a little better than the 3100 due to how its core and cache are laid out. It actually has all 4 cores and all 16 megabytes of its L3 cache on a single CCX, so there's very little latency between cores and cache, whereas the 3100 splits its cores and cache between 2 CCXs, introducing more latency and thus slightly less performance. That being said, this is a bunch of angles that you can look at this from. If you're not pairing one of these chips with a really high-end GPU like an RTX 2080 Ti, which I don't really know why you would, then the performance difference is gonna be very minimal in a real-world environment. If you're gonna be pairing one of these chips with an entry-level or mid-range graphics card, which most of us are, then the performance gap between them is more or less negligible, as most games are still very heavily GPU-dependent, which why I think it makes more sense to save the $20 and go with the cheaper Ryzen 3 3100. Not to mention, you should be able to overclock the 3100 at least a couple hundred megahertz, depending on your cooling conditions, to bump up that performance a bit further if you like. But that's the CPU that we're going with. It's $100, and it's a good chip. You should watch my Ryzen 3 review. It's very good. Now for our motherboard, I went with the Gigabyte B450M DS3H. This is a tried and true, budget, value-oriented B450 board with the AM4 socket that the Ryzen 3 chip will slot beautifully into. It also has really good reviews, like positive user reviews. I'm surprised that it has 1,400 user ratings. That's pretty impressive. It's only a $73 board here on Amazon at the time of filming. I think I was able to find it for even cheaper through PC Part Picker. But the board here is actually pretty well built. We have one of these in inventory, and I was pretty impressed by the build quality, despite how cheap it is. I love the fact that it's got 4 DIMM slots, which is not necessarily a guarantee for a board that's well under $100. I like the fact that you can expand your memory down the line. It's a board that you can somewhat grow into. It does have an NVMe M.2 slot, which is nice. PCIe Gen 3, of course. And I like the fact that it's got 2x16 PCIe slots. It also has an 8-pin power connector, none of that 4-pin nonsense. And the rear I.O., let's take a look at the rear I.O. really quick. So it looks like we have a Realtek LAN port, plenty of USB ports. I believe the 4 here are actually USB 3.1 Gen 1, and we also have HDMI and dual-link DVI out. This is really handy if you do have an iGPU. Unfortunately, the Ryzen 3 chips do not have onboard graphics, but if you did, it is kind of nice to have these video outs on the motherboard so you can actually use it for troubleshooting and things like that. It does come in handy when you need it. But most importantly, there's a combo PS2 port. Very essential in 2020. Now, memory prices change all the time, but right now, this is probably one of the best deals on a kit that I could find for DDR4 3200 speed. Even though it's got, you know, semi-okay cache latencies, nothing to write home about, it is 3200 DDR4, and it is a 16 gigabyte dual channel kit. So this is the G-Skill Aegis series. It's a really nice, good value option that I've been using for years without issue. G-Skill RAM has always been pretty reliable for me. You know, I feel like particularly when it comes to AMD based systems, when I'm setting those up, I usually never have a problem configuring XMP profiles when I'm using G-Skill memory, even if it's, you know, one of their budget kits like this. Plus 16 gigs, I think, is also a good capacity that's going to last you for plenty of years, unless you're doing some other, you know, crazy tasks like video editing. I think 16 gigs is gonna last you for quite a long time. So I would consider this a memory kit for the Aegis. In the attempts to recover from that awful joke, let's talk about storage, starting with our C drive. This is gonna be one of two drives that we put in the system. This is gonna have our Windows 10 operating system, or whatever operating system you wanna put on it, really, as well as frequently used applications, web browser, Steam, things like that. So we have the Silicon Power 256 gig SATA Rev3 A55 drive. Now, obviously, this isn't a blazing fast NVMe drive, but for a $700 gaming PC, you probably don't need one of those. This is a great way to save some money while still delivering mid-range performance in an SSD. All the reviews that I've read on this drive are very positive. It's also worth noting that while this is a DRAM-less SSD, it does feature a more advanced SLC caching technology that's supposed to really help with write performance and endurance. Two things that really fell by the wayside with some of the earlier DRAM-less SSDs to hit the market years ago. It also supports trim and garbage collection, which are very nice to have if you're gonna be doing a lot of writes to the drive. Now, of course, what would any computer be without the D? The D drive, that is. And for that, we've employed once again the Seagate Barracuda 2 TB mechanical hard drive, 3.5-inch drive, tried and true option. It's $51. I'm surprised the price hasn't gone up. I've actually seen it fluctuate here and there. Sometimes it goes for 55, sometimes it'll hit 60, but it doesn't really ever go below 50. So this is pretty much as good as it's gonna get for now. And it's a pretty good deal. It's a damn good deal for 2 TB where you can dump all of your games, all of your other mass media and storage onto. For our power supply, we're going with the Corsair CX450. 450 watt unit, 80 plus bronze certified. The CX series is a budget line from Corsair for their PSUs, but that doesn't mean they skimp on quality or reliability. I do like the 80 plus efficiency rating. That's nice to have, and it's a fairly compact unit, so if you wanted some additional clearance or space for your non-modular cables, that is available to you at the ready. You also have black cables. I believe these are black flat cables, so no ketchup and mustard here, which is always a huge plus in my book. And overall, I think 450 watts is gonna be more than adequate for this PC. Again, we've got a 65 watt TDP chip that doesn't draw a lot of power. And as you'll see with our graphics card, this is gonna be plenty for our needs, especially at 80 plus bronze. Moving on to our graphics card next, as a matter of fact, is the Gigabyte Radeon RX 5600 XT Gaming OC. 6 gigs of VRAM, this is an AMD card. Doesn't have the most positive user reviews here, which kind of alarmed me at first, but I realized that a lot of these are due to driver issues before the bug fixes that AMD released earlier this year. After that patch went out, a lot of the issues that users were experiencing with their RX series cards, like black screens, crashes, have been known to be fixed for the most part, as far as I know. So that makes it more easy to recommend these AMD GPUs because they're actually really good values. In my testing, I found the RX 5600 XT to be a good deal faster than NVIDIA's GTX 1660 Ti, which often goes for around the same price. So frames per dollar wise, this card has it beat, hands down. The card features AMD's latest 7-nanometer RDNA architecture, and I really like this cooler. The WindForce cooler from Gigabyte is a nice cooler, A, because it's cool and quiet. The fact that it has triple fans instead of one or two fans allows them to spin at slightly lower RPM so they don't get as noisy. They're just good quality fans all around. And plus, it's a two-slot design, so even if you're trying to fit this into a really small, like small form factor case, it's exactly two slot. As long as you have enough room for its length, you're probably not gonna run into many clearance issues when it comes to its height or its width, as it's a relatively slender card. Performance-wise though, this card's an absolute bang for the buck. I mean, it's gonna be able to push well over 60 FPS on average in the vast majority of titles at 1080p max settings, no questions asked. It'll even get your foot in the door to 1440p gaming as well. Now, having said all of that, I am gonna offer an alternative GPU to those of you who are looking to use this $700 gaming PC for streaming as well. Because the 4 cores and 8 threads on the 3100 are gonna be more or less occupied with whatever game you're throwing at it, it would definitely be worth considering shelling out an extra 40 bucks or so for something like the EVGA RTX 2060 KO. This being an NVIDIA RTX card, it does have NV encoder built in, so you can leverage that for live streaming if you wanted to offload some of that work from the CPU. This would probably be a better choice than an AMD card equivalent. But if you're a gaming purist and don't give a damn about streaming, the RX 5600 XT is simply going to give you more frames for your dollar. The last part on this list is the case, and many of you will hate me for this choice, but that's okay, because I have thick skin. I'm a thick boy. This is the DIY PC F2. The F stands for, why the F would you pick this case, Kyle? Well, let me tell you why. For starters, it's dirt cheap, okay? It's $39. I know it says it's on sale, but you can often find this case for this price pretty much every week. They figured out that no one will pay more than $40 for this case. And with the money we've saved on the case, we're allocating those dollars to other parts of the build that'll actually elevate our gaming performance.
Hey guys, something else I should have mentioned here is that I only chose this case in order to stay under a strict $700 budget, as the title of this video suggests. But if you can spare a few extra bucks, I would definitely recommend going for something like the Fantex P300, which features much better build quality, cable management, and aesthetics. An alternative option is the Fractal Design Focus G Mini. While it does have an acrylic window, which isn't the best, it ships with two 120mm fans and delivers pretty decent airflow for the price. This case also looks better than the DIY PC in my opinion, but then again, so does my left nut. If you're just looking for the most dirt cheap case possible and you don't want to spend a dime over $700, here's what else I had to say about this pretty garbo case.
The interior layout could not be more basic. It's got a couple cutouts for routing cables. I'm surprised it even has room behind the motherboard tray, which is good because you want to obviously hide those hideous front panel connectors. I like the fact that the power supply mount is on the bottom. Not a huge fan of cases, like really cheap cases like this, where the PSU is on top. Just makes the system a bit more top heavy. And overall, I still think it's hideous, but if it's going to allow us to build a better, faster PC overall, then all I really need this case to do is not explode and keep my parts from being stepped on, so they're not like on the ground, just like, or on a cardboard box. Some of those pictures that you guys have submitted to me. Just spend 40 bucks and get a crappy case like this. It's better than putting all your parts in a pizza box. I should point out it does have USB 3.0 on the front too. It's only one port, but it does have two USB 2.0 ports, which are actually pretty handy for like dongles and things like that. Okay. That's it. Those are the parts. This is my $700 1080p gaming PC. You guys let me know what you think, how you would have modified or done things differently. Feel free to leave your suggestions down below. As always, guys, thank you so much for watching this one. Toss a like before you go. Get subscribed for more tech content on the way. Thanks again for watching, and I'll see y'all in the next video.